Good morning to all of you. We gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. Boy, what a big week. What a big, big week.
Wow.
And again, it just reinforces the fact and how we need to be reminding ourselves again and again that God is in control. He's on His throne. He's always on schedule. I'm thankful that though the wrong, what's the hymn say? Though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. Did you read our daily bread this morning? We forget. We want to remember our veterans this week as well. Wednesday, the 11th of November, that's a day that's never changed. It's always the 11th of November. And we want to honor our vets and to thank the Lord for their service, our country. And boy, I'll tell you, we're living in a day and age when it doesn't make any sense at all to cut back on military and to defund our police. That's ridiculous behavior, especially since the Bible says that lawlessness will be on the increase in the end times. And so it makes sense to support these folks and to thank God for them. And there are men and women in uniform, of various uniforms, that really fit their uniform well. And we praise God and thank God for them. For our call to worship today, we could turn into our hymn books to 127. There's a responsive reading here called "The Lord on High is Mighty." Hallelujah for that. The Lord on High is Mighty. 127, your hymnal, you'll see this responsive reading. And notice that there are some statements the men will do, others the women will do. So observe carefully. So there aren't any guys trying to blend in with the ladies on the ladies' lines. And the men's lines will try to do our part, okay? So let's follow this together. The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The world is firmly established. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters. Your statutes stand firm. The Lord on High is mighty. Amen and amen today. Let's bow for prayer. Father, on this glorious, most beautiful day, this time of year, we say thank you. We love you. We are on the receiving end of more gifts and blessings and benefits than we could ever count. Thank you for being so kind. And right now, Lord, our country could use a lot of that kindness and grace. We need you so desperately, Father. We pray, be merciful to us. Thank you, Lord, for our veterans. And as we honor them, we pray that you'll bless them and thank you for their service. Many who've paid the ultimate price for our freedoms. Thank you for those with us this morning who have had background in the service. We thank you for each one of them. Thank you for our country. Lord, we pray, help us to maintain not only our freedoms, but Lord, the freedom to worship and to gather and to assemble. Help us to be unafraid. Help us to realize that, Lord, we need sometimes to obey you rather than men. So, Lord, if it comes to this, may we be good soldiers of Christ and standing firm in our faith. And bless this worship that you will be glorified and magnified in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Lori, I am glad you came today. More than one reason. You're a good song leader, you're a worship leader, you're inspirational. I could go on and on and on with you.
In honor of the vets that are here today, our church is full of vets. You can go down
yes,
the list,
that's right.
It's mighty long. And even the young guys and gals.
Yes.
So in honor of our vets, could we stand and sing the Star Spangled Banner, please? Mm-hmm. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so of praise 129, great and mighty is the Lord our God.
Mm-hmm.
power and love. Our God is an awesome God. in the antiphonal praise, I ask if the choir would be the echo, please, and I'll lead the congregation, and then we'll all join us in the alleluias. Are we supposed to be singing now, or?
Praise the Lord. Let's grab our Bibles and let's turn to 1 Chronicles 29. 1 Chronicles, chapter 29, starting with verse 6. This is a fascinating time in Israel's history, and the significance of this passage is a special prayer David offers in light of offerings and gifts and things coming in for the temple. And we know it was during David's time that it was preparation, the gathering of various items to do the work. And then Solomon comes to the throne and the temple is built in his days during a time of peace and prosperity. David wanted to do it, right? But God said, no, this is a period of war. Wartime is not a good time to build a temple. This passage is really super. And what really caught my eye was that word victory in our passage today. 1 Chronicles 29, verse 6. Then the leaders of the fathers' houses, leaders of the tribes of Israel, the captains of thousands and of hundreds, with the officers over the king's work, offered willingly. Notice that adverb, offered willingly. they gave for the work of the house of God 5,000 talents and 10,000 derricks of gold, 10,000 talents of silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, and 100,000 talents of iron. And whoever had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the house of the Lord into the hand of Jehiel the Gershonite. Then the people rejoiced, for they had offered willingly, because with a loyal heart they had offered willingly to the Lord. And King David also rejoiced greatly. Therefore, David blessed the Lord before all the congregation, and David said, "Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, and the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and in earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you reign over all. In your hand is power and might. In your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name." Wouldn't you love to hear that prayer coming out of Washington and Albany? It's possible. Nothing's too difficult for God. You may be seated. Ushers, if you could please assemble and prepare today for the morning offering. It's wonderful that here at Yates Baptist Church we can give and we can offer willingly. Isn't that a nice thing? Willingly, beautiful word. Not by compulsion or obligation necessarily, but just such a freedom in our giving. And God will provide. That's His promise. Let's come together, men. God has given so much. We thank the Lord for our veterans and men and women who have given so much and are giving up so much so that we might be able to come here on Sunday morning and worship the Lord freely. Brother Gary, would you offer the blessing?
Our gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for watching over us. We thank you for who you are.
Amen. Yes.
Lord, we ask that you would both bless the gift and the givers, watch over us, protect us, keep our families safe and well.
Yes.
Be with us now this day with the message and all the fellowship that we have here and with all this family together, your children, worshiping you, following you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
praise God from whom all blessings flow. Glory.
7:30, stand up for Jesus.
Yes. You may be seated. Let's bow for prayer. Father, we come before you humbly and thankfully for this lovely day, this opportunity to worship. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And in the midst of such a changing landscape, we're so very thankful that you're unchanging. The truth shall endure to all generations. We're thankful, Lord, that we have the word of truth. We have the spirit of truth. May the truth never be decayed in our lives. May we stand up for Jesus. Father, help our church family. Some may be laid aside. Beds of illness, some may be in a facility where I'm sure in this experience, in this rough year, Father, some are experiencing tremendous loneliness. May they be so sensitive to your presence. Help all those that are serving on the front lines, not only our veterans, but all who are tending to the needs of hurting people out there. There's plenty to go around. We thank you, Lord, for your word. Help the Kistner family continue to bring blessing and healing, protection. Help those that, Lord, have had recent surgeries, those who maybe are facing it. We pray you'll comfort. We thank you for those who serve the public so well. We thank you for our missionaries, their faithful labor. Thank you for helping my brother Lindy through a very intense week of Bible translation. Word has it, it went well. They reached their goal. A whole 9 chapters of Genesis translated into a tribal dialect in a way they can know and understand clearly what the Bible is saying. Amazing service. Thank you for everyone who is serving you around the world. Help our country. Father, I am so thankful that in the midst of all the confusion and wondering what's going to happen, we're thankful that we have you as our triumphant leader. You're the one who has already won the victory, won the war. And if we're on the Lord's side, it's going to be okay. We don't have to live in fear and anxiety and depression. We can live with victory. And Lord, learn to be an overcomer rather than to be overcome. Help us in thy strength alone. As we open up the Word of God, we pray that it would be clear. We thank you for the children. Thank you, Lord, for helping us with family night, for Nicole and Genoa and others who have pitched in. Help us as we continue to develop our Sunday school, that you'll provide, Lord, willing help, and that children can be helped, that youth can be helped, that parents can get good instruction. And Father, that we might have a teaching ministry that will help build disciples. Guide the video series starting tonight, that as we learn about this matter of truth, that, Lord, it would be helpful and informative, not just educational, but it would make us stronger in spirit, serving the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this sense of togetherness. We love you. We praise you for watching over every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to have us turn to 2 Corinthians this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, starting with verse 10. The Corinthian epistles are, boy, loaded, packed with so much truth. Keep in mind, 1 Corinthians, Paul wrote a letter to this church body because they were having problems. It was in a very real sense, it was a divided church. Unity was lacking. Cliques were forming. And instead of maturing in their faith, they were really carnal Christians. If you ever wonder what a carnal Christian is, let me just put it succinctly. A carnal Christian is a self-centered Christian. That sounds like a contradiction, but there's a lot of it that we face. Self-centeredness, that's carnality. Satisfying ourselves, doing what we want to do. And you might say, as a Christian, is it possible to feel that way? Yes. Yes. If we're not walking in the Spirit and filled with the Spirit every day, guess what the alternative is? We're going to go our own way. Do what we want to do, say what we want to say, and build our lives around our priorities rather than God's priorities. And there's a huge difference there. Okay? So 1 Corinthians is really a letter of correction. They had questions in Corinth about various things. There were some pretty tough and bad things going on in the church, not just doctrinal division and doctrinal issues, but there were moral problems as well. If you look at 1 Corinthians 5, there was a man who was in deep immorality. And Paul said there's real need to make purity and holiness a real priority in the church. Because if you don't, these things like a canker or a cancer can spread, even like leaven, and affect the whole body. This is something that we'd just rather look away from. But if we expect discipline in our homes, it amazes me. We would say, Mom and Dad need to have a sense of leadership and authority in a home, and there's a need for discipline in the home. If there's a need for discipline in the home, why do we think as a local church, as a family, there's no need for discipline? But the Word of God is God's means of discipline. And the Bible teaches us not only what to believe, but it teaches us about moral purity. Moral purity. And this man was living in an immoral relationship, and the church wasn't doing anything about it. And Paul says, you need to do something about this. And he was firm when he needed to be. But then we look later on, and we find apparently this man came under conviction and felt bad about what he did and sought help and guidance and wanted to get back with the Lord again. And now Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 is saying, now with this kind of attitude, you need to reach out to this person and love them and forgive them and restore them to the fellowship. We're quick to discipline. You see, this is the problem, I think. We're quick to swing the axe and at the root, you might say, but we're slow to restore. And I don't believe that this is God's method. God's method is to really see a person come to humility and repentance. And then as a church, we need to reach out in love and forgiveness. If we fail to do that when there's a sense of repentance, we have fallen short of God's goal here. We need to bring them back in. And Paul says, reach out, love, and forgive this person as I would, he says. And this is the basis of what he's saying in verse 10 in our text. Now when we come to verse 11 of 2 Corinthians 2, this gets into heavy-duty territory. If we're unwilling to love and reach out in forgiveness to this person who has fallen but wants to get back on track, Satan can get an advantage and he can just undo a ministry in no time at all. One thing that amazes me, sometimes it can take years to build up a church ministry. But a church can fall apart in just a matter of a short period of time. And my, how we need to guard our love, our unity. As a church, we need to put emphasis on sound doctrine and teaching here. We need to put great emphasis on biblical righteousness, moral purity, because the world is anything but that. Our country is just becoming morally and spiritually corrupt by the day. And if we don't shine for Christ, if we are not that example to one another and to our community, we have no business keeping our doors open. We might as well shut down and make this an antiques storage place. And that's what's happening to a lot of church buildings today. They're either storage places or they're places to suit the pleasure of the public, or many church buildings have been leveled to the ground. Why? Because they've gotten away from this. And they have become cultural Christians, or if we want to use that terminology, and they've gotten away from the Bible as absolute truth, and they have become very much saturated in worldly thinking and philosophy. And as a result, they die out. They die out. Paul says, love and forgive this person, lest, verse 11, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we're not ignorant of his devices. Notice that? We're not ignorant of his devices. Furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel and a door was opened unto me of the Lord, I had no rest in my spirit because I found not Titus my brother. But taking my leave of them, I went from thence into Macedonia. Now, thanks. Verse 14 is the hub of the wheel here. Verse 14. Now thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ, and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ, in them that are saved and in them that perish. To the one we're the savor of death unto death, to the other the savor of life unto life. And who is sufficient for these things? Who is adequate? For we are not as many. Notice verse 17. We are not as many which corrupt the word of God. But as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ. I'd appreciate if on your guide sheet if you could look over that opening paragraph. I think it gives some good reminders for us. But let me just share these points with you. First of all, as we learn to follow Jesus' lead in victory, we will produce, first of all, vigilance. Vigilance in our conflict with the adversary. Satan, by the way, means opponent or adversary. Okay? It's kind of an interesting thing to get the meanings of these words. Why does he say, be loving and forgiving, lest Satan get the advantage? Because Satan sometimes can get the advantage in our churches today. He gets the advantage in our homes. Be very careful. Rick Renner says in his commentary, the word advantage means to outwit, to trick, to take advantage of someone through some sinister or sneaky means. Did you ever notice in Genesis, right at the very beginning, what does it say about the serpent? The serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field. That sets the stage for what many look upon the Old Testament in what they call the trail of the serpent. Satan's efforts to thwart God's plan and purpose. He did everything he could possibly do to cut off the line through which Christ would come. And my, you know all about the murderous plot of Herod during the birth of Jesus and the slaying of all those little boys throughout the region. Satan's efforts to hinder and to thwart God's purpose. The good news is Jesus has already won the victory, and Paul pictures Christ as the lead, kind of like the field marshal leading his troops. He leads us in victory, and we follow him in the train of his triumph. Okay? Back in Paul's day, wasn't anything unusual for Roman generals to march through the streets when they had a victory, and their soldiers who they were proud of. And many times they'd take their captives, those they had taken captive, POWs, they would parade them through the street as well. And Paul is using this word picture to help us see that Jesus at the cross won the victory over sin and over Satan. And now, because of his victory, we rest in him and we follow him in this victorious parade and procession. Interesting thoughts here. The word devices that he uses in verse 11 denotes Satan's insidious, malevolent plot to attack and victimize human beings. Devices. Paul says we're not ignorant. Here's the first point too. Know your enemy. Many times we think of people who we view as the enemy. Someone wisely said they're not so much our enemy, but victims of the enemy. I think that reveals some good insight. Victims. They're victims. We've seen this. I've seen it in my 20 years here. I've seen people overcome and become victims of the enemy. I see Christians that have been kidnapped by Satan and are held captive to this day. What can ever change it? What can release it? fasting and prayer don't hurt. Prayer. So important. How many times I've had to be reminded, Lyle, you can't do this in your own strength. It's impossible. We try. We get discouraged. And at times as a human being, it can get kind of spooky when you deal with people's lives. Demonic spirits abound in the United States. They're busy. What are they doing? They're out to steal, to kill, to destroy. And my goodness, they're on the verge of succeeding. The way it would appear. Vigilance. Secondly, as we follow Jesus leading victory, we will have perseverance in the Lord's work. Be not weary in well-doing, Paul writes, because in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Why don't we reap? Why don't we see the blessing? Because we give up and quit. I've had enough. Paul came to Troas. Notice this in our text. He came to the city of Troas and God opened up an amazing door. But something happened where it could be possible that Satan hindered Titus from coming to Troas. And Paul wasn't sure what was going on, what happened. And sometimes things don't turn out the way we might expect. I see it over and over and over again in ministry. Oh, we just sometimes run into roadblocks, and boy, Satan's busy hindering things. Oh, how he hinders. How he tries to hold up things of what the Lord's seeking to do. Titus, by the way, was a guy, here's one of the guys in the list that was refreshing. I can almost tell by the scriptures, he had a personality that could light up a room. Sometimes in the ministry and the Lord's work, we need people like that. Titus was that way. Paul was eager to meet up with Titus to get a report of the believers. Paul wrote the first letter to Corinth. Many believe Titus delivered the letter to the believers in Corinth. And he's eager to join up with Titus to see how the church responded to what Paul wrote. Paul said, I wrote this letter to you, he says, with many a tear. Picture Paul sitting down at a small table with parchment, writing, tears coming down his cheeks. Teardrops falling upon the parchment as he wrote because he had some tough things to say. And he was concerned that the folks would take it in the right way and make some progress. The good news, they were coming along. And when you get into the second letter, instead of spending much of the time correcting them, he's commending them. Boy, I'll tell you, when we need to discipline our kids, let me just say this. It is so important we back up discipline and sometimes having to do that with that quick word of praise. You know why our kids aren't turning out today? Because they get very little love and praise in the home today. It's all negative. No, 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 don't do this, don't do that. And there's nothing positive. Paul had to kind of exercise a sense of discipline with his congregation, but my, he learned perseverance in the Lord's work here. So not only do we need to know our enemy, we need to know our triumphant leader. Who is he? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our triumphant leader who leads this victorious procession. Thirdly, the sweet fragrance of Christ will rise from our lives. This is a beautiful picture. In fact, in those parades, often they would have soldiers that would also have censers where incense would burn in those censers in the parade, and that sweet aroma would go to, in those days, to honor their captain, their field marshal. Well, our lives can be sweet fragrance to God and can bring honor and glory to the one who's already won the victory for us. Let me ask you a question, Christian. Is your life, your witness, your attitude, your mannerisms, is it a sweet fragrance? You know, amen, Patty. Sometimes we're a sweet fragrance, sometimes we're stenchy saints. Ooh. Sometimes I feel like my life is like a nice, sweet smelling incense, other times is more like the county landfill. I guess that's a reality check. We don't mean it to be that way, but sometimes that's the way it is. But when Jesus is in charge of our lives, when the Holy Spirit controls our lives and He's in the driver's seat, our lives will emit a sweet fragrance. Why? Because that will attract people to Christ rather than repel. Something to think about. Imagine our influence on others being a refreshment to God. Wow. Can you imagine your life refreshing God's heart? That's what he's talking about here also. And then finally here, diligence. As we learn to follow Jesus leading victory, we will produce diligence in the proper handling of God's Word. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, "For our exhortation was not of deceit, nor of uncleanness, nor in guile or deceit here, but as we were allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak." We've been given a serious responsibility. God has entrusted us with His Word. We are ambassadors for Christ, and someday we're going to report in and give an account of what has been done. The disciples went out, and they reported back to Jesus what happened. There was an accountability there. Same holds true of us. Someday we're going to stand before Jesus as His servants, as His soldiers, and we're going to give an account of our life and ministry. So know your enemy, first of all. Know your triumphant leader and captain, secondly, and finally, too, know your Bible, folks. Know your Bible. Learn as much Scripture as you can. Get into it. Follow it. Thy Word is a lamp to my feet, a light unto my path. Oh, there's so much. I've got a little bit from Oswald Chambers, and with this I'll close. How many of you read Oswald Chambers? Anybody? Quite a bunch of you. If you're still on the milk of the Word, I might not recommend it. It's pretty heavy-duty reading. You're not ready for a good steak. Still on the milk of the Word, and that's okay, but we need to keep growing, learning. Listen to this, folks. This really got my attention. He says, "The viewpoint of a worker for God must not be as near the highest as he can get. It must be the highest. Be careful to maintain strenuously God's point of view. It has to be done every day, bit by bit. Don't think on the finite. No outside power can touch the viewpoint. The viewpoint to maintain is that we are here for one purpose only, to be captives," listen to this, "to be captives in the train of Christ's triumphs. We are not in God's showroom. We are here to exhibit one thing, the absolute captivity of our lives to Christ. Well put. We're in a new captivity. We used to be captives of Satan. Now we're captives of Christ. Amen? How small the other points of view are. I'm standing alone battling for Jesus. I have to maintain the cause of Christ and hold this fort for Him. Paul says, I'm in the train of a conqueror. And it does not matter what the difficulties are. I am always led in triumph. Is this idea being worked out practically in us? Paul's secret joy was that God took him, a red-handed rebel against Jesus Christ, and made him a captive, and now that is all he's here for. Paul's joy was to be a captive of the Lord. He had no other interest in heaven or in earth. It is a shameful thing for a Christian to talk about getting the victory. Interesting. The victor ought to have got us so completely that it is his victory all the time. And we are more than conquerors through him. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ. He says in closing, we are enwheeled with the odor of Jesus. And wherever we go, catch us now, wherever we go, we are a wonderful refreshment to God. He calls it the viewpoint. I'd say it's pretty accurate, wouldn't you? Know your Bible, folks. The Word of Truth. Thank you for listening. I appreciate it. Well, I'll tell you, these are the strangest times I think we've been in a long, long time. But I'm so glad the shepherd, the captain of our salvation, leads the way. There was a beautiful hymn we sometimes sing, and sometimes we have a tendency to forget some of these great hymns of the faith. Jesus led me all the way. All the way my Savior leads me. Oh, wow. Let's remind ourselves of this often. Hymn number 353 as we sing Victory for Jesus. Victory for Jesus, number 353 in closing.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His glory, of His precious blood's atoning. I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me.
my friend, again, you don't need to be a born loser when you can be a born again winner. Amen. Father in heaven, we're here rejoicing as we remind ourselves again the war has been won. We are triumphant in Christ. We can take on any Goliath that's out there in Jesus' name as we wield the sword of the Spirit. So help us in this, Lord. Help us not to be on the losing side. Help us not to be discouraged. But Lord, keep us strong and courageous in Christ. Help us to go forward into conflict and, Lord, stand up for Jesus and to stand firm and hold our ground. In His name we pray today. Amen.